The H-Town takeover has begun in Houston, and the path takes them to New Orleans, a top 25 ranking for the first time in 4 years, and one of the most electrifying dual-threat quarterbacks has Houston in championship mode. It's never easy to win in the Bayou on a Friday night, and Tulane looks to win their third straight at Yulman Stadium. Kickoff coming up next. Welcome to the American Conference on ESPN. Friday Night Lights in the Bayou. It's an American West showdown as the Houston Cougars at 5-0, 2-0 in the American Athletic Conference get set to take on the Green Wave of Tulane at 2-3. Sean Kinney alongside former NFL tight end Brian Kinchin. Great to have you with us. You take a look at the Western Division of the American Conference. It is stacked with talent. Three teams currently at 2-0 with Houston, Memphis, and Navy. Tulane will try to jump in the fray with an upset here on this Friday night in front of their home fans, a place that they have been tough through the years. Houston's been the talk of the country here, one of the more dominant programs. Tom Herman has put the Cougars back in the national spotlight, and he's working his magic once again with a young quarterback in Greg Ward Jr.
Yes, he is a true dual threat quarterback who likes to move the football with his feet, whether he's in the pocket or he's rolling around the edge and delivering the ball downfield with his arm or on design runs, whether it's a quarterback draw or a sweep straight around the edge. He is very dynamic, very hard to defend. Tulane can only hope really to contain him tonight.
The road got a little bit tougher for Tulane. The offense has been struggling. They found out this week their starting quarterback Tanner Lee is out with a concussion. So here comes Devin Powell.
Devin Powell is another dual threat quarterback. He is more of a runner. Curtis Johnson, the head coach for Tulane, has been looking for that all year to balance out his offense. And he's hoping tonight he can give him that balance that he's much needed running the football.
Houston won the toss. They elected to defer, so it will be Devin Glenn and Tulane to get the football here as Ty Cummings tees it up for the Houston Cougars, and we are underway from New Orleans. Great to have you with us. An American West showdown as the freshman Glenn races out past the 15. He is hit hard up around the 17-yard line, so good special teams coverage by Houston. Brian, we take a look at the key players starting offensively for Tulane. Who has to step forward tonight?
Yeah, Sherman Beatty is the guy who is, he's multi-talented. He's a very well-rounded running back. They need to find a way to get him in space when they have to throw the football and capitalize on matchups with linebackers. He's very effective catching the football out of the backfield. And on the other side of the football, we Landon Roberts. He is their playmaker. He's the guy who leads this defense, and he's going to have to be on all cylinders this evening.
Devin Powell making just his fourth career start. Expect a lot of this on the ground as they give it off to Rob Kelly. First play, a marker comes flying in as Kelly takes it up ahead to the 23, but let's see what the flag is all about. That's the wide receiver, Teddy Veal. And for this Tulane offense last week and a loss to Temple, they have more penalties than first down. They were penalized 9 times. And Devin Powell will try to change their fortunes. We mentioned just his fourth career start. What's he bring to the table for the Green Wave offense tonight?
He gives them a solid backup who hopes to come in and to be able to spark this offense. This offense has struggled all year long, and they're trying to find an identity, and they're hoping that he can bring that to him tonight.
After the penalty, there is not much up the middle. This stout Houston defense, the Cougars, one of the country's best at stopping the run, allowing 95 yards per game. It's going to be tough chugging inside for the Green Wave.
And it's what Tulane struggles with, running the football. And 2 weeks ago, when they were here back in Yulman, they had penalties galore as well. Had them on early downs and get in situations that they just can't recover from.
Second down and 13. Powell will keep it, try to scoot to the outside. Not much there, and there's one of our impact players, a Landon Roberts, cutting off the corner for Houston.
And they're really high on him. They like him a lot. Todd Orlando, the defensive coordinator, talked about he is a very vocal leader, number 44. And he's a hard worker at practice every day. He said he's just a great human being. I want somebody to say that about me someday, but he just talked like he was his son, how much love he had for his job and what he does down there for that defense for the Cougars.
Such a balanced Houston attack with their offense and the defense. Guys like Hightower and some of the secondary players, an experienced personnel unit forcing third and long for the Green Wave. Houston brings some pressure. Powell's going to throw for the first time. Sideline pattern right on cue, but about a yard shy of the first down. Teddy Veal holds it in. Brandon Wilson with the coverage.
That was a great job by Veal. I watched him run that route over and over and over again in pregame warmups, and I don't think I saw them miss it one time. Obviously, a third and long is very, very difficult to convert, but Veal needs to do a better job of knowing where the chains are. I know that was a very, very long route, but you need to take that to about 15 or 16 to make sure that he gets that first down.
Peter Piccarelli, four-year punter, airs, makes an unorthodox catch, dancing his way through green defenders, finally takes it up to the 42-yard line, a return of 4 yards on the 36-yard punt. So good starting shape for this high-powered Houston offense. This Cougar offense has put up monster numbers through the first five games. There is a marker down on the punt. So here we go, Brian. The same Bugaboos come back to bite Tulane. The very first play on their offensive scrimmage, a penalty now on special teams. And that is not good when you're trying to slow down Greg Ward Jr. Third in the FBS in rushing touchdowns. He's the only player in the country to throw for 200 a game and average more than triple digits on the ground as well. Phenomenal talent. The scary part is it's only his 14th start. This guy was a wide receiver at this time of the season last year. From the 49-yard line, Ward is going to throw. Has time. Home run ball. Tulane defender slips and falls wide open for the touchdown. On the very first play, Chance Allen, 49 yards. And the Cougars are on the board.
They have 12 drives this year that have been scored in 2 minutes or less. They have five that have been scored in a minute or less. We can add six to that number. We talked about how dynamic he is no matter what he's doing. Beautiful pinpoint accuracy on his first throw of the game.
Saw the Green Wave defender fall down. That's Perry Nickerson, the freshman All-American, who ironically picked off Ward a couple of times in last year's game in Houston. But 2015, a new story, a new theme for the Cougars. Greg Ward, 49 yards to Chance Allen. Seven nothing, Houston on top. One of the questions coming in for the Cougars, who would step in at the receiver position, losing four of their top six guys from a season ago, and the transfer from Oregon has had a big start. Chance Allen, the 49-yard touchdown strike. Houston on their first drives this year. They have scored a touchdown every single time. They make it 6-for-6 tonight here in New Orleans. One play, 49 yards. Allen with a second touchdown catch. And Houston could not have scripted a better start. 7-0 on top. Hobbling the football near the goal line and all sorts of trouble for the freshman Glenn, trying to use his speed to get to the outside. Not much. And for the second straight time, Tulane deep in their own end.
Speed like that works in high school. It doesn't work in FBS football. Downhill, up the middle is what a kick returner is supposed to do.
So let's see what Powell can do on his second drive. He completed the one pass on third down. He hooked up with Beal, not enough for the first down. They had the early penalty that forced them back. So now they begin possession number two, trailing 7-0. On first down. They give it over the left side. Not much there. Again, it's going to be tough jugging against this Houston D. It's a pickup of two for the sophomore Dontrell Hilliard.
Tulane's going to use a little tempo here. Talking to Todd Orlando, the defensive coordinator for Houston, he said the tempo does not work well with his guys up front.
Two straight carries for Hilliard as he takes it up near the 20-yard line, keeps his balance for a moment, then he's wrapped up. Brandon Wilson finished the job. Four more yards, setting up third down. This Houston defense has been tough. They're one of the best in the country at stopping the run, mainly because of the linebacking corps.
And the funny thing is that number that they give up is exactly what Tulane gets per game, which puts them at 122 in the nation. And the bad thing about being one-dimensional, which Tulane has been this year throwing the football, is it has created doubt in that offensive line. They don't function well now when they try to run the football, and it eats away at them. They've got to be able to gain some confidence, which they did earlier in the year versus Maine and UCF.
They pitch it to the outside, trying to get some room as Beatty with his first touch. Not happening. He's chopped down 2 yards on the run, and fourth down for Tulane, another three and out.
And that confidence was stewing throughout the entire football team. Coming off of those two wins and last week versus Temple, they came out the gate hungry, confident, and got up 10-7 on a Temple team that has not lost a football game, but it quickly eroded and faded away back to reality where they've lived most of the year.
Ayers awaiting the kick, Piccarelli. High spiraling kick. Ayers on the back pedal. Fields at the 31. Ayers slips free from a couple of defenders. Still on his feet. Keeps his balance. Cuts to the outside. How about the return by Ayers as he'll take it all the way up to the Green Wave 33-yard line. All Houston early. 32 yards on the return. Cougar football when we come back. Here in New Orleans, 7-0 Houston on top for the second straight drive. The Cougars open up on the Tulane side, this time after the electrifying return from DeMarcus Ayers at the 33-yard line. Greg Ward Jr. on first down will hand it straight up the middle. Not much for Ryan Jackson. Offensively, Kenneth Farrow has been the main guy in the backfield with Ward. He is a good one, a three-time captain for the Cougars.
Yeah, he's a three-year starter, the senior leader, the guy who's going to gain the most yardage on the ground other than Greg Ward. And Nico Marley is the heart and soul of that Tulane defense. He will be all over the field tonight. He shoots gaps, he reads offenses, and makes plays.
Second down snap is a bad one. Trouble brewing and a huge loss back at the 47-yard line. Eric Thomas, the junior inside linebacker. And this offensive line is battered and beaten for Houston. If there's a weakness, it's up front because of the injury bug.
Well, they've lost three guys in the last couple of weeks. And the center position is the most valuable. Unfortunately, Colton Freeman is their starting center. We shouldn't have those type of problems in our sixth game of the year. They need to be consistent. That needs to be automatic every time they line up, getting that ball back to Ward.
Could be a big moment early in this football game. A little momentum maybe by the Green Wave defense. Nothing open downfield. Ward will try to scramble. Puts on the brakes along the sideline. And then the wheels gave out at the 37-yard line when it looked like he was just on the verge of creating something pretty special there.
Well, and you saw the result of just not being used to this type of field. This is a turf field. It has a little bit of a slip to it. A lot of guys who come in here aren't used to it. You see that happen, but we got a glimpse of how dynamic he is. He takes a play and turns it into an unbelievable play. Major Applewhite talked about him being an eraser-type quarterback. A bad play, he'll just erase it, and he'll look to the sideline. He'll get the first down. He'll say, "What's next, coach?" We almost saw him pull it off there, but the turf monster stepped up and got him.
Houston's going to let the play clock wind down, and the Cougars on fourth down will utilize a timeout. 7-0, Houston on top. Tulane trying to come up with a stop here. Houston did not take a timeout, so the delay of game call, and now the Cougars will send the punting unit out. It's a big stop for the Green Wave defense.
Yeah, after the one play touchdown, I'm sure Curtis Johnson on the sideline for Tulane, the head coach, is extremely happy to see that.
Piper will try to pin Tulane deep. High end over end kick, takes a bounce at the 1 yard line. And Houston special teams coming together in the front of the goal line. That should be a touchback. I think that's what the officials have come back and rule. Don't forget, we got a pair of outstanding matchups Saturday on ESPN at 3:30 Eastern. Number 7 Michigan State is in Ann Arbor to battle Jim Harbaugh's 12th-ranked Wolverines. And then at 7 o'clock, it's a huge showdown between two of the SEC's 3 undefeated teams, number 8 Florida, number 6 LSU. Both games can be seen on ESPN, also streaming live on Watch ESPN. Touchback takes it back to the 20-yard line. Third offensive series for Tulane. Still in search of their first down. Devin Powell, the veteran player, coming out of the bullpen here for the injured sophomore Tanner Lee. First down completion of a hit, Trey Scott.
Those are the throws that you want to see him make. Those are the throws that Tanner Lee was working on before he was injured last week. Quick timing throws. Once he hits his back foot, the ball comes out of his hand. Trey Scott, one of their tight ends who they line up out wide, is a very good receiver type tight end.
Important for Tulane to stay on schedule these first and second downs as Beatty is gang tackled at the line of scrimmage. Cameron Malvo, the defensive end, the junior from Beaumont, Texas, the first one in.
Yeah, they don't need to be in third and medium, third and long. It's not situations that this offense can convert. Even with Tanner Lee at quarterback, it's very difficult. And you put a guy like Devin back there who hasn't been in these situations, it makes it even more difficult.
Split backs on third down. They were looking for the slant. That's a low throw. It is a forward pass as they rule it incomplete. They were looking for the initial slant to the top of the screen, but nothing there. So Tulane on the punt, another three and out. And you saw the electricity created by DeMarcus Ayers on the last punt return, setting up Houston in good shape.
This is the guy last year who is the American Conference Special Teams Player of the Year as a returner. We see why, a very dynamic return guy who just refused to go down.
See if Piccarelli tries to keep it away. Here they come, and Piccarelli goes down, no marker. Ayers holds it in, and Tulane does a much better job on special teams. Malik Eugene, the first one down to greet Ayers. 6:43 to go in the first quarter. It's been a rough start for the Green Wave. Houston on top, 7-0 here in the Bayou. Rewind button to November 8th of last season. A heavy underdog in Tulane stunned Houston in front of their home crowd as the Green Wave was able to strike early and often. Tanner Lee, the first of 3 touchdown passes. Dontrell Hilliard had a big day, 5 catches for 107 yards. And then this interception in the front of the end zone by Perry Nickerson sealed it. 4 interceptions thrown by Greg Ward. The two coaches come together and Tulane pulls off 31-24 victory a season ago, but 2015 is certainly different. Where has Ward changed the most from last year?
Well, I think it's just the tutelage of Tom Herman, who has come in and just done a miraculous job of teaching this young man the intricacies and the nuances of the position of quarterback.
On first down, this is Kenneth Farrow picking up 5.
And he's talked about how he's seeing this guy grow up right in front of him as a quarterback. And it's directly because of Tom Herman and what he's been able to do. The atmosphere and the culture that he has created since walking into the job as the head coach here at Houston. And having a quarterback who can lead and build confidence in a football team is monumental in that process.
Houston has been able to run the football successfully all season because of the talents of Ward and Farrell, the experienced back. Tulane doing a good job. This defensive front four is as skilled as they come in the American Athletic Conference, and Coach Herman knew that coming in. It was going to be difficult. This is a defense that's very aggressive, and they rely on the negative plays.
Lionel Washington, the defensive coordinator, played 16 years in the NFL. He likes to run the same type of defenses that he was a part of back then. He'll get up and press. He'll risk. He'll bring pressure. He has very much confidence in his cornerbacks to be on an island in man coverage.
Four receivers set. Ward zips it far sideline. Caught. First down. Chance Allen with the catch. And the Cougars convert on third down right in front of Perry Nickerson.
And believe it or not, that's the least dangerous that Ward is when he sits in the pocket and makes a throw. Because when he starts to move, anything can happen. He is unbelievable.
Farrow dodges a missile, shooting through untouched that time was Nico Marley, and he missed him. Thomas was able to get the tackle, but it looked like Marley was in a prime position to deliver another TFL for this Tulane defense.
They don't miss many of them. They are very, very good at finding the football, especially Nico Marley and Eric Thomas, those two middle linebackers shooting gaps and finding the football.
Thomas led this defense with 10 tackles last week. Markers all over the place in the zone read as Ward dodges to the right side, but let's see what the flag is. Tulane thinks it's
holding
on Houston.
Number 73, offense. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Second down.
And it is. It's the center, Colton Freeman.
And again, all of the injuries on that offensive line, but yet Colton Freeman, the center, who's their mainstay, a bad snap earlier and now a holding call, getting them way behind. Second and long is not where they need to be. But if there's a guy who can get you out of it, it's Greg Ward.
Mason Dinley making his first career start. It's a line that features four guys that are first-year starters for Houston. A fake left. Ward wants to dump it to Farrow, and he is met hard by Darian Monroe, who read the play perfectly.
And the funny thing about Ward is when you roll him out, you almost limit him because you're only giving him one side of the football field. When you let him sit back in the pocket, he can go anywhere if the play breaks down. But when he's rolling, especially to the short side as we just saw it, he's kind of stuck on where he can go with the football and whether or not he can bring it down and run it as well.
Let's see what Major Applewhite dials up here. Third and long, they run a stunt. Houston counters with a screen, couple of blockers out in front. But the green wave able to corral Houston shy of midfield. They needed 19. They pick up 13. And that sets up fourth down for Houston.
They ran a screen on both sides. Ward had his option. He went to the far side into the boundary. Chance Allen, number 21, does a really good job of getting what he can and really manages field position on that possession. They didn't get points, but they gained field position. They're able to pin Tulane back again on their next possession.
Tom Herman has watched his team come up empty on their last two possessions. Piper on the punt, not a real good one. Charging up with the fair catch at the 23. So the Tulane defense holding the forts here, waiting for that offense to get started. 7-0, Cougars on top. Fourth time that Tulane has had the football. The Green Wave still searching for their first down. From the 23, straight drop. Powell toward the sideline. Not much room there. Blanket coverage from William Jackson.
We get a great look at number 3, Jackson. Todd Orlando, the defensive coordinator, talked about he is their best cover corner. He was listed with Phil Steele as a preseason All-American and All-American Conference player. And he has total and complete faith in him. He will flip him if he wants to defend a jersey, a.k.a. Teddy Veal, or the boundary, whatever it might be.
Big thing about Jackson talking with Orlando is his size. He added about 9 pounds during the offseason. You see the big hammer put on by Roberts, one of your impact players. These linebackers are headhunters when you look at Steven Taylor and Roberts and Bowser.
Well, Roberts leads the nation in solo tackles per game, 8.6. And they come in that form, I don't want to be anywhere around that. That is just pure power. And football skills right there.
Real vocal leader of this Houston defense, putting together a phenomenal senior year, really his first year starting. Powell's going to throw, has a receiver open downfield, but he overshot Teddy Veal, incomplete. And the Green Wave offense struggling in this first quarter to find any type of openings, any type of rhythm against the Houston D.
Well, Curtis Johnson talked about Devin Powell giving that Michael Vick type performance. Vick, the backup in Pittsburgh, has played well against Baltimore 2 weeks ago and won against San Diego on Monday night. And he was hoping that Powell could give him that same type of energy, that same type of electricity. But when you're missing throws and can't make first downs, that's a very, very tough thing to do.
Tulane using a special teams timeout. Curtis C.J. Johnson in his fourth year, the 1985 Idaho grad, New Orleans native, St. Charles High School graduate nearby. In his fourth year, trying to get this program back on track. Frustrated with that last timeout.
And they've had a rough start. Their three losses have been monumental, lopsided losses against Duke and Georgia Tech. And last week versus Temple, the few wins they've had have been against FCS Maine and then the winless Central Florida football team. So what they've gotten in wins has been very, very minimal, and their losses have been just monumental losses, very lopsided.
Very young team in New Orleans as Piccarelli gets the kick away. Line drive, Ayers has some room, watch out. Ayers trying to get to the outside, stays on his feet, has a wall of blockers, and Ayers takes it to the Tulane 43-yard line. For the third time in this quarter, Houston's going to open up on the Green Wave side, and you are just flirting with disaster if you're Tulane in this high-powered offense.
And I don't think it's surprising that we haven't seen Tulane get first downs. What's been surprising is that this Houston offense that is so high-powered has been stopped on the last two possessions they've had after that one-play series on the first drive that went for a touchdown. But Tulane has done a good job defensively. Lionel Washington has got a game plan where he's trying to contain Greg Ward as best they can do it.
Ryan Jackson, the tailback, he flanks Ward to his left on first down. They're going to run the option. Ward looking. He'll keep it toward the side and get out of bounds at the 39-yard line. They get the 38. So many different looks that Tom Herman will throw at you offensively with an athlete like Ward.
They do very unique offense. They run a triple option where they'll run that read option. But Ward will come around the edge and even be able to have the option to throw it downfield. It's very unique. And with his skill set, this offense fits him perfectly.
Draw all the way for Ward, trying to shake and bake ahead. Not much. Eric Thomas again. We mentioned the strong game he had last week, leading the team in tackles with his 8 solo stops and a couple of TFLs. Third down for Houston. I have to believe, though, this is 4 down territory for the Cougars.
It will be interesting. I find it very, very difficult to understand why they can't get Ward out of the pocket better. 9 times out of 10, he's getting out of the pocket on his own. But the way that they've designed those first couple of runs have been very ineffective against this Tulane defense.
Tulane rushes 4. The offensive line picks it up for a moment. Now Ward scrambling. Marker comes in, and Ward is forced to throw it away. This will be a hold as Royce LaFrance was putting on the heat, and he was drugged down. That is Carter Wall, who for the most part this season has been at left guard, but due to the injuries, he's back on the right side, a first-year starter. We mentioned the offensive line troubles. If there's anything that's going to slow down this juggernaut that Houston has cooking this year, it's the injuries up front. Ben Due injured his foot against Texas State. He's out for the year. Last week was just a painful week as Zach Johnson and Josh Thomas were both lost for the season as well. Third down and 14 after the penalty. Ward looking downfield. Nothing open. He'll take a shot. He paid the price. And here comes the marker. He was drilled by Nico Marley.
First down.
That is a killer penalty for Tulane, and it looked like they had the stop.
And we talked about Lionel Washington, how he likes to take risks. They sent three receivers vertical, and they were all in man coverage, and they sent everyone else. That was eight guys, and Nico just needs to be a little bit smarter. We talked about him being the heart and soul of this defense, but emotion a little bit carried over and turned into a negative, even though you could argue that that was within the boundaries, but obviously not on the Houston side.
First down takes it to the 32 as they will give it to Farrow up the middle. Not much again. Kenneth Farrow gets three.
And that's tough sledding up the middle of that two-lane defense. Corey Redwine weighs 328 pounds, and Tanzel Smart is 304. Those guys in the middle are very tough to move. And it's tough sledding inside of those tackles. Houston needs to do a better job of getting on the edge with their running game and get Ward involved in that process.
Pistol look, play fake. Ward rolls right. LaFrance chasing, pass in and out of the hands of his tight end. Setting up third down, they were looking for Tyler McCloskey, and the good-looking freshman, Roderick Teamer, making just a second start. He was with the coverage. Teamer jumping in, a very physical safety for this Tulane defense.
Yeah, he was a backup to start the year. A true freshman, he took over the starting role for Donnie Lewis. Has been a very good addition to this Tulane defense.
Another third down for the Cougars. Play clock to five, and McCloskey, the tight end who was lined up in the slot, flinched.
Number 45 offense, 5-yard penalty, third down.
Not a real crisp 15 minutes of football.
It's not. But Tom Herman was worried about this. He talked about that front of Tulane, those front four, how he felt like it was the best group that they will face or have faced all year this year. And it was a big concern for him. And they're putting a dent into the game plan of this Houston Cougar offense. And they've been very, very ineffective, except for that first play of the game.
Third down and long again. Ward improvising, trying to buy some time, and he threads the needle. Ayers makes the catch in heavy traffic. They needed 13. They pick up 15 yards on the completion to DeMarcus Ayers.
And that's what's great about a quarterback like Ward, who can extend the play, get out of the pocket, keeps his eyes downfield. You can't maintain coverage for that long and be effective.
Ayers makes his second straight catch. He's wrapped up immediately by Monroe.
I like Houston's getting into some tempo here. I like tempo as a mixture. I love when you get something going, you continue to get to line of scrimmage, and you get the defense on their heels moving backwards and just continue to press them.
Farrow straight up the middle on what should be the final play of this first quarter. So Houston on the doorstep. As we move to quarter number two, the Cougars with a 7-0 lead underneath the moon here in New Orleans. Houston in the national rankings for the first time since 2011. They started with a bang on the completion to Allen, and the hits just kept it coming. Cougars by 7. Welcome back to Yulman Stadium. Beautiful Friday night in New Orleans. A lot of folks have made the drive from Houston. The Cougars on top of Tulane as we start quarter number two. 7-0, Houston on top. They scored on their very first play from the line of scrimmage. And despite dominating the statistics in this first period, just 7 points on the board. Trying to change it here. Third down and three. Inside the red zone for the first time. Farrow's the back. Ward's going to keep it up the middle. Pick up a block from Farrow. Scoot to the outside. Picks up a block from Allen. Touchdown. Houston. He's done it again. Greg Ward, 12 yards. And the Cougars strike again.
Tom Herman talked about how he didn't like his quarterback running the ball too much. The called quarterback draw, the perfect call on third and short. But a lot of times, even when he's supposed to be throwing the football, he says he takes off and runs. He doesn't like that. He didn't like him getting hit. But I'm sure if you asked him about that one, he's very, very happy to get six out of it.
Eight plays, 43 yards. Let's not forget, it looked like Tulane had the drive stopped, but a mental mistake by Monroe as he hit Ward high on a third down incompletion. The 15-yard penalty kept the drive alive, and Houston takes full advantage. Point after, up and through for the Cougars. Greg Ward rushed for four touchdowns last week. He's already set the Houston single season record for rushing touchdowns by a quarterback. He has number 12 here in the Bayou tonight. A 12-yard beauty. Cougars on top, 14-0. Eight plays, 43 yards, a little more than 2 minutes off the clock. And again, you just go back to the hit on the quarterback there, Tulane. What has prevented them from taking the next step to consistent winning football? These penalties and these mental mistakes, and it came back to bite them right there.
And they are. They're silly mistakes. You can't allow them to happen, especially from your older players, your leaders. A guy like Nico Marley should know better, should not allow stuff like that to happen, but they elongate drives. They give him situations that are more manageable. And with a guy like Greg Ward at quarterback, who is so dynamic, you don't need to give him anything more than he earns on his own, because he's going to beat you eventually. You're not going to be able to hold him down all night, as we saw right there on that third and short.
Goes through the end zone for the touchback. Celebrating its 10th year sponsoring the Good Hands Fuel Goal Nets, Allstate makes contributions to participating universities' general scholarship funds for each field goal and extra point kick. Since 2005, Allstate has contributed millions of dollars in scholarship funds. A green wave offense that has put up 38 yards in the opening 15 minutes, still searching for their first down. Devin Powell under center, and they will go to the ground game, and here comes an array of flags again. Nothing there. Roberts busting up the party in the center of the Houston D.
Holding, 68 of the offense. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. First down.
Who's DeVinis, the big left tackle, the 6'7", 305-pound giant.
And we just talked about the veterans on this football team. This is a five-year senior. A guy, when we talked to Curtis Johnson about who was his best offensive lineman, he names him, and he names Chris Taylor, their right guard. Guys just cannot allow those to happen. And I know it's all in the heat of the battle, but holding is holding. You got to pull that hand down when that jersey starts to stretch, because they're going to call it every single time, especially out on the edge.
All looking to set up the screen. It's caught on the deflection. Beatty somehow pulled it in when it looked like Houston might have the interception. Great read there by Stephen Taylor. Loss of four.
Stephen Taylor wishes he had that one back. On defense, sometimes you just get surprised that the ball is right there. You can't believe he actually threw it and gets a little bit tripped up. Obviously frustrated. Taylor, very dynamic player off of the edge, has such incredible quickness and agility. That would have been an easy six had he stayed on his feet.
Tulane moving the wrong way, now operating from the shadows of their own goal line. Good job of the line giving protection. Throw downfield, knocked away. Wilson with the coverage. They were trying to hook up with Andrew Hicks.
It looked like Powell knew he had nothing and just decided to put that one up on the boundary. And that's not a bad idea, but you can't underthrow it. You have to give your receiver a chance. You have to try to get it out in front of him. And he was double covered by Wilson, number 26. And the safety over the top. But sometimes desperate times call for desperate measures. And that looked like a desperate one right there.
Just 16 yards through the air so far for Devin Powell. In there for the injured Tanner Lee, the redshirt junior from New Orleans. Here comes pressure. Somehow he stays on his feet. He'll take it to the sideline, and here comes a late hit. Wow, you talk about dodging a bullet.
Our penalty from the end of the run. First down.
William Jackson on a cornerback blitz had Powell dead to right in the front of the end zone.
Powell does a good job of eluding the free rusher off the edge. William Jackson, who comes from his corner position, and then again, a very borderline hit that's just fractionally.
It will be enforced half the distance to the goal, and the ball will be set. After the play was over, personal foul with a late hit out of bounds, number 16 of the defense. That 15-yard penalty will then be enforced. First down.
Just keeps getting uglier.
Well, I saw that play unfold with Chris Taylor, who I had just talked about how Curtis Johnson had talked about how he was one of their better offensive linemen, and I saw him make that hit. I saw that flag come out, but I thought that referee was looking at the late hit, but obviously caught him making contact in the back while Devin Powell was trying to run around the edge, and just not smart on either side of the football right there.
So Tulane gets their first down on the penalty. They go with two tight ends, a power formation over the left side, straight up the middle with tough running from Dontrell Hilliard. He picks up six.
And I like that look. I like it. Let them know you're going to run the football. Get your big guys on the field. Dontrell Hilliard is more of their downhill running back. He's not as versatile as Beatty. He's your hard yard guy. And I like that. You gain 7 yards. You're in second and third. That's a great situation. They need to keep that chain alignment perfect all night for Powell to be able to have success behind center.
Up the middle they go, and not much this time as Houston is there to defend it well. Kelly brought down by Roberts. Jawing back and forth, setting up third down. Tulane without Zedrick Thompson. He is out for the second straight game. He's a big power back they love to go to, and you see the numbers and the struggles this year for the Green Wave on third down. It was really interesting talking to the two sets of coaches. Third down defense was a point of emphasis for Orlando. He wanted to see that area improve, and they're off to a good start in this first half tonight.
And this is a manageable distance for Tulane as opposed to what they've had earlier in the year.
Slant pattern is caught and a first down. Veal with the catch right in front of Wilson. And Tulane with back-to-back first downs, trying to get something positive started.
Because those third down percentages don't tell you how long you were trying to go on third down. And Tulane all year has been trying to get third and medium, third and long. You don't convert on those. And third and three or four, you can manage those. You can convert those.
Trying to get to the outside using the stiff arm. Pass midfield, out of bounds. Tough run by Dontrell Hilliard. Again, Roberts escorting him out, but not before Hilliard picks up 14.
Eric Price, the offensive coordinator for Tulane, needs to stick to what he's doing well. He's got this Houston, this very athletic defense. It's very active. They like to bring pressure. They like to come at offenses. They've got them on their heels now. Continue to try to pound the football, mix in some play action with Powell behind center, short, high percentage throws.
All is going to throw, has all sorts of time. Deep ball into double coverage, knocked away by Jackson, incomplete. They were looking for Devin Bro, the track star for Tulane, but double coverage with safety help coming over the top.
Yeah, Lee Hightower, number 18, their backup safety, a transfer from Boise State. He's a 2-year starter. He took a poor angle and really let that ball get behind him. It should have been caught. It would have been a very, very good catch to make by Devin Bro, but he's certainly capable. But He doesn't even make a play on it. Hightower, number 18, over the top.
Second down, Beatty, nowhere to go. He is met at the point. B.J. Singleton, the nose guard, in on the stop. And in this 3-4 defense, it's a little bit of a different look for Houston this year with Todd Orlando, the defensive coordinator who came over from Logan in his days with Utah State. He brought this 3-4 with him. And in this particular alignment, guys like Singleton and Malvo and Mark, they're not going to put up big numbers, but they are responsible for eating up those five offensive linemen and let linebackers flow to the ball.
Yeah, they play head up on the center, head up on the tackle, a two-gap technique. Their job is to occupy the big guys while the linebackers get all the glory.
Here comes the blitz off the edge. Houston picks it up. Powell's going to take a shot. 50-50 ball incomplete. Excellent coverage by Wilson. And after a couple of first downs, Berman has watched his defense come up with the stop.
Now, let's just talk football. What did I just get through talking about early in that series of what they were doing well? Running the football, pounding the ball, 3 yards in a cloud of dust. Talk to Eric Price. Eric Price, stick to what we're doing well. And then all of a sudden you see three balls move down the field. It just doesn't make sense.
Here's a fake on the punt. All sorts of room down the sideline. Kelly to the 20, to the 10, down to the 3-yard line. Gutsy call that pays off. The bag of tricks under the crescent moon here tonight. 43 yards on the fake.
2 weeks ago versus UCF. Early in the football game, Tulane had a 4th-and-2, ran the same identical play on a punt, but gave it to Marshall Wadley, one of their other running backs. Same result. Huge yardage that gives their offense great field position to be able to punch it in the next three downs.
First and goal, straight up the middle, touchdown. Tulane. Dontrell Hilliard with his third rushing touchdown of the year. And you talk about getting what the doctor ordered, the fake punt dialed up at the opportune time. And a little momentum for Tulane as they continue their perfection inside the red zone.
Of all the categories in offense, they have one that they're the best at, and we just saw.
Dontrell Hilliard scored a couple of touchdowns last year in the upset win at Houston. He has number one tonight. Power football up the middle. Green wave back in. Valerie's there, Brian Tulane here in New Orleans. Some of the great cooking when you come down. You're used to it, though. That's nothing new for you. Us Midwest guys, that's something to wait an hour in line for right there.
Cafe Du Monde, every time I leave out of here on Sundays with my wife, we go and grab us some beignets from the original place where they came from.
14-7, Houston on top. A little bit of life thanks to the special teams and the fake punt. But here comes Houston on the return when it looked like Wilson was generating a full head of steam. He's tripped up. Still solid return up to the 32-yard line. Tulane offense able to get something started on that last drive after being pretty much bottled up. They were bottled up for their first four drives, just 28 yards. But again, 43 of those 75 coming on the fake punt call.
Take them how you can get them. Doesn't matter where. Special teams, you got to be adept at all three phases of the football game, and you certainly can't fall asleep, which Houston did on that punt.
See how Ward and the Cougar offense responds. Shift McCloskey, the tight end, to the right on first down. And here comes a marker. Looks like some movement on the right side for Houston.
5-yard penalty, first down.
Curtis C.J. Johnson in his fourth year Mentioned the New Orleans native, over 28 years of coaching experience. He was the wide receiver coach with the Saints before he took the program over here at Tulane. Spent some time with Miami, part of the 2001 national championship run for the Hurricanes.
His goal was to keep a lot of the guys in Louisiana and New Orleans home, and he's been able to do that on the recruiting trail.
Ward off talk. Off target, a rare misfire to Chance Allen. We mentioned Ward's completion percentage coming into the season. That was one thing Major Applewhite talked about. A lot of people not giving him enough credit for his accuracy and how he can throw the ball.
Well, an athletic quarterback usually uses his legs more than he does his arm, but his arm is really very accurate. Last week, he only missed two throws, had an 88% completion percentage against SMU in that football game.
Second down and 15. Slant is caught. It's a minimal pickup. Stephen Dunbar, Louisiana kid, one of 10 Louisiana natives on this Houston roster, making his first catch.
Yeah, Rummel High School, right down Metairie, Louisiana, not far from here. One of the few Curtis Johnson let get away. But we saw him slip on the turf right there. We've seen that about three times from the Houston team. Seems like they would have done a better job of testing out their cleats before the game. They're seeing what works and what doesn't work well on this turf.
Tulane rushes four. Ward floats and it's caught. This will all be dependent on the spot. Terrace Chanel with the coverage. Looks like he'll be a yard shy, and this has been a spirited effort by the Tulane D tonight.
They have done a really good job, and we talked about it in the open, of trying to contain Ward. They certainly weren't going to stop him, but they've done a very good job of containing him, putting hits on him and making sure he knows that they're there even when balls aren't completed.
Big play here, fourth and a yard. Ward picks up the first down and ends up out of bounds at the Tulane 47-yard line, shoved out by Jared Franklin. It's a pickup of 14. And how about the call, fourth and a yard in your own territory?
Again, we just keep going back to when you have a guy like that, you have such a luxury. And when you have guys downfield that will block and can block, it's just a huge difference maker. We see Chance Allen, number 21, out on the edge, giving him all the room he needs to get that first down.
So a big fourth down conversion for Houston. Ward looked like he wanted to go deep. He'll settle near side and nearly intercepted. Nickerson had his hands on it. Breakdown in communication with the quarterback and receiver.
Obviously, that's not something that you want to see as a head football coach. One of the few decisions that Ward shouldn't have made, but obviously not on the same page with Chance Allen. On the route, looked like it was supposed to be a comeback, but Allen saw the coverage underneath and tried to take it vertical instead.
See the quarterback of this defense for Tulane, Monroe, making sure everybody's in their spots, but he forgot about the seam. Wide open airs, slips free of a tackle. Monroe trying to chase him, and he catches him at the 5. 41 yards on the completion. On a breakdown in the coverage defensively by the Tulane secondary.
Communication, that's a problem. They lost three of their four defensive backfield from last year. And communication has been an issue. When you like to go man coverage and bring pressure, you got to cover everybody on the field.
Ward's found the end zone for the second time in this first half, using his speed. And the Cougars respond with an impressive drive.
What an answer. What an answer to that two-lane drive. Ward decided that, you know what, I need to start playing some football now. And kind of woke him up and that offense up. They had been stagnant there for a while, trying to find their feet, but the credit goes to Tulane's defense of keeping them off balance. And now they're kind of finding their stride somewhat.
Point after good for Houston. So the Cougars take it down the field. They up the ante 21-7 here in New Orleans. The word Heisman has popped up around Houston for the junior Greg Ward out of Tyler, Texas, and three more touchdowns in the first half, showing the ability to throw the football on the very first play of the game and then use his speed and agility for the next two.
On that third and three with the quarterback draw right up the middle of the defense, and then he goes around the edge on the next touchdown, just a straight Wildcat or Wild Cougar formation. But the great thing about it is you don't have to put anybody else in. You just use your same quarterback and run the play straight around the edge. And a defense like Tulane's is a very, very quick and athletic defense, shouldn't be able to allow that to happen, but he just has such great speed that it's hard to stop.
You just can't help but compare him to the start of the career for Braxton Miller and what Herman was able to accomplish with Ohio State the past couple of years, and what he is doing with Greg Ward Jr. in this Houston offense in such a short time. Again, Ward Jr., a receiver. He came on late last year. He's 11-2 as a starter. Lit a fire with the Cougar offense last season. He's kept that torch lit brightly here in 2015.
And he made a mention to the fact that he was a lot like Braxton Miller, who played too early. And he's had to do a lot of repairing to what he had suffered through last year in these 10 months that he's been here as the head coach at Houston.
Tulane coming off their best drive of the night. Bootleg action as Powell throws, too tall, incomplete. They continue to work on Brandon Wilson, but he was there with tight coverage. It's another tough test for number one Ohio State on Saturday Night Football, presented by Wells Fargo. The Buckeyes and their two quarterback attacks. Speaking of quarterbacks, Cardale Jones, JT Barrett take on Penn State and their tough defense. Ezekiel Elliott and the Buckeyes welcome the Nittany Lions to the Shoe. Penn State top-ranked Ohio State Saturday, 8 o'clock Eastern on ABC, also streaming live on Watch ESPN. Second down give over the left side, 2, maybe 3 yards up near the 30. Rob Kelly's been the most effective ball carrier for the deep running back position for Tulane. They're thin up front on the offensive line. They have just 6 scholarship players in the receiving corps, but they do have a number of running backs who can get the job done.
Yeah, they do. Rob Kelly is their most powerful back. He's their biggest. He's mature as can be, according to Curtis Johnson. He's not really that vocal as a leader, but he certainly leads by the way that he runs that football downhill, getting hard yards.
Tulane, 1 of 6 on third down. They bring a linebacker blitz, and they got the Powell just in time. Forward pass incomplete. Heat coming up the middle from Trevin Stewart. This secondary has so much experience. When you look at Stewart, the senior, McDonald and Jackson, a lot of talent in the back end of the Houston D.
Yeah, they returned every one of their defensive backs from last year. They all have experience. They're all very, very good at what they do. Coach Todd Orlando, the defensive coordinator, has a lot of faith in them to put them in man coverage and trust them with that.
Bearcat signaled for by Ayers, who's had a dynamic night on the returns. Houston football when we come back. Cougars on top, 21-7. Last year, Tom Herman found himself on the sideline of the national championship game, January 12th, Ohio State and Oregon. The Buckeyes had unleashed an offensive arsenal unmatched in all of college football. Ezekiel Elliott with a 33-yard touchdown run, and the Buckeyes just kept it pouring in on Oregon. A yard out as the Buckeyes capture the national championship, Urban Meyer and company with the crown. And his main guy on that offensive side of the football was Tom Herman, the offensive coordinator and quarterback coach, the winner of the Broyles Award given to the top assistant in college football. And he has brought a lot of the same system, a lot of the same philosophy here to Houston. And boy, has it ever paid off in year number one.
Well, he talked about how Urban Meyer is his most influential coach. He runs his system and his program very similarly to the way that he does.
44 points per game last year for the Buckeyes, 5th highest. Mentioned capturing the Broyles Award and hired as Houston's head coach. And a lot of the discipline, a lot of the same thing that he witnessed with Urban Meyer. The two continue to keep contact. He's instilled with this Houston offense, and you look at the numbers that the Cougars have put up under the guidance of Herman, along with offensive coordinator Major Applewhite, which was a big hire as well for this Houston attack.
10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Second down.
Had previous stints at Iowa State. He was in Ames for 3 years and Rice for a couple of years. His offenses with the Owls broke 40 school records. He had some ties here in the state of Texas, spent some time with Texas State, Sam Houston State, Texas and Texas Lutheran. So he had connections. He's used those connections. He's hired a coaching staff full of Texans, and it's all coming together. After the penalty on second down, they stretch it with Farrow. Here comes another marker. Not much for Farrow. He's brought down by Thomas, the middle linebacker. Flag thrown in the vicinity of a hole. It's McCloskey, the tight end.
And talking to Major Applewhite about the tight end, he says you have to have a tight end to be successful. You have to be able to cover that C gap. And when they got there, they had no tight ends on the roster. He's actually a converted H-back, McCloskey. But obviously a silly mistake, and you cannot put your team in a hole like this.
Second and a mile for Ward. Empty backfield. They go five receivers. Ward, pocket collapsing, runs into the back of his own blocker, being pursued by Tanzel Smart. And a wise decision as he goes out of bounds. And, yeah, you mentioned the tight end position for Houston, something they really haven't utilized through the years, but Herman certainly has in his offenses. You go back to Rice, James Casey, 111 receptions for the Owls, a season record for Rice. And then Colin Franklin, 54 catches at Iowa State. So that is a position moving forward that he wants to get back, part of this offensive attack.
And obviously, as a former tight end, I love to hear that.
Music to your ears. Third down and long. Pressure comes again. Ward floats downfield, airs, dives, but cannot haul it in. Incomplete. Franklin with the coverage. And the penalties hurt Houston as they're forced to punt.
Well, we saw it earlier in the game where they took the shorter and underneath throw to manage field position. They don't convert there, and Tulane will have pretty decent field position, even though Ward put the ball right where it needed to be. Only where his guy could get it just came up a hair short on bringing it in.
Piper to punt from the seven. Veal awaits the kick. It's a beauty. High spiraling kick. Fair catch signal for at the 27. A 51-yard bomb by Logan Piper. Houston on top, 21-7. Tulane offense back onto the field. In a backfield loaded with depth, Dontrell Hilliard has been the main guy tonight. The 5'11 sophomore out of Baton Rouge has been able to find some openings. There hasn't been many crevices against this Houston defense, but tough running from Hilliard for the second straight year against the Cougars.
And Curtis Johnson has wanted his running backs to get yards after contact. We see some great examples of how he's able to do that and how they have benefited from that, and obviously getting to the end zone for six in the end.
What would you like to see from Tulane in this offensive series as we approach that 5-minute mark?
They need to hit more play action, not straight drop back.
A little hitch pattern is caught. Jumping up high, Teddy Veal to make the catch. Coming back on the tackle was Malvo. Pickup of 11 and a first down.
The problem that Tulane's had all year is because they haven't run the football very well. They haven't been able to use play action. But this, very good timing route, gets out of the hands of Powell quickly to the receiver where he knows he's going to be, and the conversion is made.
See if that gives Powell some confidence. Just a second completion in his last seven attempts. Two in a row to Veal on the screen, but there is nowhere to go. Gang tackling, count them up. One, two, three, four defenders around the play.
And I like that call. It's a quick wide receiver screen. The problem is if the ball was in the air too long. They were too far away, and he didn't get the ball quick enough to be able to make something with it when he got it.
Trevon Stewart in on that last stop. Third in the country among active players in career tackles. He has been a tackling machine through the years in the back end of the Cougar secondary. Malvo, another stop. setting up a third and eight. Start taking a look at the clock, and this is where the game got away from SMU last week. In the Houston battle, the Cougars just poured it on late in the first half to create a little separation. First down goes a long way here for the Green Wave. Third down and eight. Here comes the blitz. Beatty picks it up. The throw incomplete. Was there early contact? No. Perfectly timed play by the defense, William Jackson. And Tulane is forced to punt. They were looking for Andrew Hicks.
And Jackson is the guy that they want in coverage. Hicks does a good job of running the route exactly the distance he needs, but he needed to press him just a hair further to get him a little bit further onto his heels and then come back just a little harder to the quarterback, so he's still ahead of the chains and they get the first down.
Piccarelli on the punt. Another deep kick, airs on the back pedal, Fields at the six. There's a block in the back, so this is coming back as Ayers takes it out near the 25-yard line. Houston, with the penalty, will have it deep in their own end with 3:26 to play in this first half. This will be the eighth Cougar penalty in the first half.
Well, if I'm coaching that football team, that's way too many.
During the return, illegal block in the back, number three of the receiving team. Penalty will be enforced half the distance to the goal, first down.
And you can give them off to effort. Effort is okay if you just make a mistake, but when you consciously are hitting someone in the back or you're holding a jersey or you're jumping off sides, just silly penalties, those are what are very difficult for coaches to have to take.
Houston with all three timeouts, their worst starting position of the night. Deep in their own end from the 10-yard line, Greg Ward, three more touchdowns in this first half. LaFrance chasing. Ward throws on the run. Caught.
Like to see a little tempo out of Houston here. Not necessarily a two-minute offense, but a nice completion, moving the chains, and to get them on their heels a little bit.
First down, straight up the middle. Big hole for Jackson. He'll carry a defender with him an extra 4 or 5 yards up to the 47-yard line. Pickup of 19 yards and a quick hitter right up the gut.
And that's what a good pass on the perimeter will do. It'll open up the inside of that defense, which is very, very difficult to run against with Tulane.
Zone read. Ward elects to keep it. Cuts upfield promptly. Zigs to the left. Up to the 39. 15 more yards. And another first down for Houston. Boy, he is fun to watch, isn't he?
He is dynamic. If the word could ever describe a quarterback, that would be it. He is just a pleasure to the eyes.
So they've already covered 50 yards on three plays. Clock, really not a factor. 2.5 to go in quarter number two. Plus, they're sitting on a stockpile of timeouts. From the 40-yard line, two receivers to the right. Ward dropped the snap, picks it up, says no problem. I'll throw a strike to Ayers at the 19-yard line.
How
21 more yards.
Nonchalant was that. That was like he had dropped something in the kitchen and just decided to pick it up. And, oh, yeah, by the way, I'm going to throw it down the field for 30 yards.
Tulane trying to get some bodies off the field. They're gassed. They did not. They were late. Getting off. Looked like the ball might have popped free on the handoff. But again, Tulane had a couple of guys. One of them was big Sean Wilson sprinting to the sideline. Tulane thinks they have the football, but it's coming back with a penalty.
And penalties hurt you no matter what. But when situations like this come up and your team has made a really good play and then a silly penalty, simple substitution penalty, is going to cost you not just yardage, it's going to cost you possession of the football. That's what's really tough. And that's on the coaches, though, getting those kids in and out. They got to be do a better job of that.
Offside, defense. The penalty would be 5 yards from the previous spot. Replay first down.
Wasn't a substitution thing. It was just a simple offsides. Discipline. Got to have discipline. What a break for Houston.
See the frustrated look on Curtis Johnson's face. And Houston is inside the red zone tonight at the 15-yard line. Jackson, who has a big run on this drive, will be the lead blocker here as they run the end around to Ayers. Has a couple of big bodies out in front. Touchdown, Houston, DeMarcus Ayers on a block from Mason Dinley in open space. Runs right into Cougar Nation in the corner.
Well, Tulane had him, one up on the trickery. But credit Major Applewhite, checking the column of perfect call, perfect time, perfect execution. And the guy that you want to have the football, DeMarcus Ayers, who is excellent in open space.
How about the block by Mason Dinley, a banged up offensive line. They've made their mistakes in this first half. But the redshirt freshman in his first career start getting out in front of Ayers that time and putting the finishing touches with his block. And Houston gets a late score in this first half. They made that drive look effortless. 90 yards in a snap of the finger, and the Cougars in control here in New Orleans.
The perfect timing. You run the sweep with the quarterback into the boundary and give the ball back to Ayers, who has the entire field with a lineman leading him to pay dirt. Excellent call by Major Applewhite.
Five plays, 90 yards. DeMarcus Ayers, one of those guys who has really stepped up. We mentioned they lost four of their top six wide receivers from last year, including Deontay Greenberry, who skipped his senior year to give a shot to the NFL draft. And Ayers is one of those guys who was just waiting for the opportunity. He talked about it, how frustrating it was, you know, to sit and not be the main guy. Well, he has responded this year. Major Applewhite wants to get him the football as many times as they can. 12, 13 touches a game. A lot of it receiving, some of it running like we just saw there. So Tulane back in a hole as the return takes it out to the 23-yard line. Don't forget this week, College Game Day, built by the Home Depot, is coming to you from Ann Arbor. A big one, the Big Ten battle, Michigan State and Michigan. Join Reese, Kirk, Dez, Lee Corso, and the rest of the crew because they get you ready for the games like nobody else can. It all starts Saturday morning, 9 o'clock Eastern on ESPN, also streaming live on Watch ESPN. Who do you like there? Michigan State, Michigan tomorrow.
Well, Michigan's pitched three straight shutouts, but they haven't faced a quarterback like Connor Cook for Michigan State. I think it's going to be a tall order for them. It's going to be a tough victory to bring home, and I don't think they pull it off.
From the 24, the slant knocked away. Bro kind of gave up on the route, it looked like. He never went to the football, and that allowed the defender to reach around Wilson again and make the play.
Yeah, he alligator armed that, and down here, everybody knows what that means. He shortened up those arms. He didn't want to lay out and take the hit. But so you've got to be able to take those for your team, convert those conversions to give them manageable distances.
McDonald cheats up. He comes on a safety blitz, and what a hit put on William Jackson. We heard about him all week. Here's a guy that might be the highest draft pick in the upcoming NFL draft from the American Athletic Conference, making another play using his size.
Again, just a little bit of a hesitation on Devin Bro's part right there because he knew the lick was coming. And we talked to Todd Orlando, the defensive coordinator. He projected him as a fifth-round pick, William Jackson, number three. Said he's big, strong, and can run. He said last year was a little tentative when he watched him on film, but this year he's added his own little flavor to the position.
Here comes the blitz again. They hand it off, nothing cooking. Adrian McDonald, another veteran in the back end of that secondary. And Todd Orlando, if you could script up a drive defensively, that's exactly how he wants to play. Get the negative yards on first and second, and then open up the creativity with the blitzes on third down.
Well, the hit you saw from Jackson, that's inspirational to his teammates. They see that. They see that type of play. And then they're all inspired, and they come out, shut them down up the middle, negative yardage play, take a little bit of two lanes methodology defensively, and turn it on themselves with a tackle for a loss.
Coming up at halftime, we'll preview Virginia Tech in Miami, a critical ACC showdown this weekend, Boston College and Clemson as well. Kirk Herbstreit's top four things to watch for on what's shaping up to be a sensational Saturday, all coming up on the halftime report. It's been a busy first half for Piccarelli. Markers down as Ayers has open space. The punter, Piccarelli, dodges, cuts back to the center, still on his feet. He'll take it in for the score, but there is a flag down back at midfield. I know 12 or 13 touches was the goal, but the way this guy is running.
Return, holding number 23 of the receiving team. The penalty will be 10 yards from the spot of the foul. First down.
It's coming back, but just finishing my point, I'm thinking more 18, 19 touches. This guy, he cannot get off his feet tonight.
Yeah, Ayers is, he's averaging 8 receptions a game, just catching the football, 11th in the nation. Last year, he was the American Conference Special Teams Player of the Year for his return ability, and we see why. But again, I hate to even keep beating a dead horse. These penalties are not just costing you yardage. In that case, we're talking about points off of the board. It's very, very tough, very, very difficult for a head coach, and I'm sure that's not high on Tom Herman's list of things that they need to be doing.
9 penalties, 75 yards for the Cougars. From the 37, time to work. They hit the tight end out of the backfield. They get 9 yards. Let's go back to the holding call, wiping out the 63-yard touchdown by Ayers.
And again, silly penalties that you just can't have, and it's really so obvious right in front of a referee. He's got no choice but to toss the hanky on the ground.
First down from 48. Ward had the initial pocket, floats and throws. Ayers makes the catch. 15 more yards up to the Tulane 39. Do you remember on that last Tulane offensive series, I said a critical time for them to try to get a first down just because what Houston has been able to do toward the tail ends of first halves? And here we go again. The Cougars putting this game on ice in the final 4 minutes, much like they did last week with SMU.
It's the only way to limit Ward is to keep him on the boundary. And they haven't been able to do that.
LaFrance from the edge. This time they get to him. Tanzel Smart, Royce LaFrance. Able to get to Greg Ward, a loss of 8. And Houston will be forced to use a timeout.
The play was over. Personal foul with a late hit piling on. Number 54, the defense. The penalty is 15 yards from the end of the play. First down.
Unbelievable. You heard the description piling on. No need for it. You had LaFrance, you had Smart. Ward was down.
Carroll
jumping in the pitcher late.
Number 54, just silly. It's over the top. No reason for that.
Drag route over the middle. Some room for Dunbar up to the 24-yard line. Keep an eye on the clock with 37 seconds. And now Houston will use a timeout. It was premature earlier with the penalty, so now they will use their second timeout. One left with 34 seconds. And Tom Herman's Cougars looking at clock management. Brian, how do they play it out here?
Well, I like what they've been doing where they empty out the backfield because it gives you a classic spread offense look. And it thins out the defense because, one, it gives Ward throwing lanes. The windows are bigger because there's five receivers out wide. But the flip side of that is if he has nothing, he uses that athleticism and finds a crease and turns it in to a quarterback draw, so to speak, and gets yardage either way. It's almost a win-win for Houston. It's very, very difficult for Tulane to defend that alignment, that empty backfield look that they've given us two or three times on this drive.
Another huge half for Greg Ward. 14 of 18 for 213 yards. He's added 53 rushing yards, three more touchdowns. Second down and short. Ward dashing to the left, and he is hit hard. A loss back at the 28-yard line. Eric Thomas, one of the first ones in there. Help out arriving from Nico Marley as well. And Houston uses their third and final timeout.
Trying to use the draw as they used it earlier on that third and three. And Tulane sniffed it out in the middle. He had no choice but to get out to the edge where Nico Marley was waiting for him.
This Tulane defense, they can make plays in the backfield. 39 tackle for losses. They had 12 in their win against UCF. Second in the American Athletic Conference. They haven't been able to get to Ward as much, except for this drive. They've been able to knock him down twice, but they haven't been able to knock down DeMarcus Ayers. Over 100 yards in this first half. Plus you throw on his punt returns as well. He has the touchdown run. Five catches, certainly a playmaker on the edge. See if they look for number 10. Third down and five, no timeouts left. And here's a pass and interception. Picked off at the 31-yard line. Nico Marley comes through, the leader of this defense.
Timing route by Ward, but totally oblivious to Nico, who's dropping to his hook curl zone. And as he looks up the field, he sees the football and reacts very well, pulling the ball in. Only the second interception on the year for Greg Ward. He's been very effective in his placement with the football. He had to be sharp. Major Applewhite was concerned about that because of the man coverage that Tulane likes to run. And we see the end result of not taking care of the football right there.
Third career interception for Nico Marley. Cypress Bay High School product. Powell is going to throw. And still on his feet, able to keep some time, looking for receivers downfield. Dipping and dodging, throws down the middle, caught at the 42 by Bro. How about that? Devin Powell taking a page out of the Greg Ward playbook there.
You got to love the tenacity and the determination on both sides of the football right there. Houston only rushed their three defensive linemen, but they were all over him. They were like bees on honey, but yet Powell does an even better job of eluding them, giving his receivers time for that coverage to break down, and he finds the open receiver and converts the first down and gives really Tulane a chance, a shot at least, with 5 seconds left in the game or the half to be able to get the ball into the end zone for a possible late touchdown, which would be a miraculous turnaround from where they were earlier in their own territory trying to defend off this Cougar offense. But just a great job of going up and getting that football and making a play, high point in the football.
So with only 5 seconds, really time for just one shot downfield toward the end zone. Here comes the blitz. Powell backpedaling, looking. He won't get away this time. Drop back at the 40 by Trevon Stewart. And that's how the first half will end. Really only appropriate that Todd Orlando's aggressive defense sends the two teams into the locker room with the sack. Tulane was able to get on the board. Dontrell Hilliard with the touchdown, but has been the case all season long. Too much. Greg Ward, DeMarcus Ayers with a big first half. Houston with the lead, in control, sending a statement here in New Orleans. Welcome back to the American Conference on ESPN. Halftime here in New Orleans, all Houston right now. The Cougars on top, 28-7 over Tulane, alongside former LSU and NFL tight end Brian Kinch and Sean Kenny back with you. And Brian, we came into this football game talking about the two quarterbacks, Greg Ward, all the publicity that he has received, the monster numbers that he has put up. And then on the opposite side, Devin Powell filling in for the injured Tanner Lee. And for the most part, both quarterbacks trying to do their job, but Ward with so much as far as his ability to throw, his ability to run, and then he adds that supporting cast around him as well.
Yeah, he does, and Powell is struggling a little bit, obviously trying to throw the football. A lot of his throws down the field, kind of helpless, desperation-type throws. They need to get him shorter underneath throws out of play action that increase his percentages for completion.
Houston will get the football first. They deferred to start the game as the kick is off the fingertips of Wilson into the end zone for the touchback. So, Brian, let's get your keys to the second half, starting with Houston if they want to maintain this lead and even expand it, building momentum for next weekend.
Well, I think what they were doing at the end of the half, they looked so nonchalant about what they were doing, and they were moving the ball at will. I like the play calling that they were able to mix in Major Applewhite, especially on that reverse, just the timing of it, the way that he's let that offense flow late in the first half. If they can continue that into the second half, it's going to turn into a long night for Tulane if they can't answer offensively.
Smart, red wine. Wilson, the three-down lineman. They go with an odd-man look here for the green wave from the 25-yard line. It's the end around the jet sweep to Ayers, who we just highlighted, and he'll get 11 yards on the very first carry. There is a marker down back at the 29. It looks like they might have hit McCloskey with another hold on the edge.
And you got to credit the offensive line for their job of filling in.
Personal foul, clipping, number 22 of the offense. Penalty will be half the distance to the goal from the spot of the foul. First down.
So it was Jackson, the running back, with the call there. But the offensive numbers and the production has once again been there for Houston.
I just again go back to that offensive line. Alex Cooper going from right tackle to left tackle, and Carter Wall going from left guard to right guard, and their backups being able to step up and really continue the cohesiveness that they've had all season long in that front five.
10 penalties already for Houston, and we're just starting the third quarter, already a season high, and nothing doing. And now some late pushing and shoving, and this Tulane defense played well in the first half, just not getting much help from the offense. And they're working against a beaten-up offensive line for Houston. Ben Due injured in the game against Texas State. Then they're all excited last week. They get two leaders back, Zach Johnson and Josh Thomas, both injured in the win against SMU. They are lost for the season. So guys like Denley and Cooper and Paris, Carter Wall, those guys having to step up in a big way to try to keep their championship hopes alive as they hit the midway point of the season.
Offside, number 96 defense. 5-yard penalty, second down.
See movement up front. That's big Corey Redwine, 6'2", 328-pounder. With the offside call. So the two down tackles, Redwine gets the offsides, and then his buddy Tanzel Smart with the unsportsmanlike conduct.
And Tanzel has issues with that. He had the same problem last time they were in Yulman Stadium versus Central Florida. Just couldn't control his emotions. We talked about how emotions are supposed to help you during the course of a football game, not hurt you, and certainly not hurt your football team.
It's an area Curtis Johnson has continued to work with his young team to curb those emotions, not take them away, but control them. 20 yards and penalties, and just like that, Houston has it back at first down. They run the quick option, forced to pitch it quickly. Not much for Jackson. He's thrown for a loss. Excellent job by Nico Marley. A loss of three on the play. Marley had the interception late in the first half. He certainly is making an impact like he normally does.
He's such an instinctual player. Curtis Johnson calls him the Energizer Bunny, the way that he works and practices.
Second and 13 after the loss. It looks like Ward is checking down, calling an audible here. He flips Jackson to his left. Blitz coming off the edge. Here come the safeties. They run straight up the middle. A couple of yards. Wilson in on the stop. Sean Wilson, one of those guys they're happy to have healthy. He is a difference maker up front. You asked the question to the coaching staff, who's going to be that leader moving forward? And Wilson's name was brought up.
They have to have that. Curtis Johnson has said they've been lacking, that they've had a young football team for a couple of years now. Well, eventually that excuse has to go away, and somebody's got to step up and be a leader both defensively and offensively.
They rush for a big third down play early in this third quarter. Ward's going to try to run for it, picks up a receiver, block downfield, tight ropes the sideline, and should have enough. Chance Allen has a few grabs, but what I have been most impressed with has been his downfield blocking. He gave the quarterback the corner for the 17-yard scramble.
And Applewhite talked about how important that is to have them be able to do that.
Huge third down conversion as they go back to the ground. Kenneth Farrow has had a quiet night. He's snowed under 4 yards over the left side.
Again, we see Houston working some tempo, which I like it used periodically during the course of the football game at the right time.
That last run by Ward, his longest of the night, 17-yard run. Now he wasn't ready for the snap. He was looking over toward the sideline, and a heads-up play by the senior and three-time captain, Kenneth Farrow, to jump on the football. It's a monster loss back to the 40.
Well, we got backup Will Noble, who's a freshman, in at center in place of Colton Freeman, their normal starting center, and obviously delivers it when he shouldn't have.
Greg Ward with an empty set. Tulane sends three. Offensive line able to contain. Now chasing is Smart. Ward still buying time. Says, I'll tuck it and run. Trying to use his speed to the outside. Stiff arms a defender. Finally corralled at the 45. Perry Nickerson brings him down. It's a 15-yard scramble from the elusive Greg Ward.
Well, third and 19. He got to 15. He almost was able to erase the play, as we talked about earlier. He's that kind of quarterback, but just a hair short of the first down, and they'll at least gain field position off the nice run.
One thing when you play Ward, you better stay in your lane. He has that cutback ability. He's done that time and time again tonight against this Tulane defense. Piper trying to pin Tulane deep. Veal comes up with the fair catch at the 11. It's a 33-yard punt. Greenway football for the first time. When we come back, a little less than 10 to go. Third quarter, Houston in control. Devin Powell and the Tulane offense deep in their own end. First touch of the second half as they try to get something going on the ground, and there is nothing there. This Houston defense, again, the linebacking core, Elandon Roberts, Stephen Taylor, they have been bringing the hits all night long for defensive coordinator Todd Orlando.
Taylor gets his one TFL of the night, and just a good job by Jackson out at the corner position, and then the endless rush by Stewart to safety up the middle.
Roberts with 7 tackles, 5 solo stops. He was the nation's leader in solo tackles entering this game. And the thing about this Houston defense, they've been good the past couple of seasons. Dave Gibbs, the defensive coordinator, did a really nice job. He went to Lubbock during the offseason. So one of the new hires for Coach Tom Herman was to bring in Todd Orlando, whose Utah State defenses have been flat-out dominant in the Mountain West. Similar style as far as the aggressive nature. And with this linebacking core and the 3-4 scheme, they can put up some video game type numbers, and that's what they have done. Throw and nearly a pick in and out of the hands of Trevon Stewart. He'd love to have that one back. This Houston defense, not only can they put heat on the quarterback, they can create the turnover. 14 turnovers on the season.
Yeah, and I like to tease those defensive guys because there's a reason they're playing defense. And it's not because they have great hands. And Trevon Stewart does a great job of getting to the football, but that's why he's playing corner and not receiver. But a valiant effort, but it would have nice to have been able to bring that one in.
From the goal line, Piccarelli gets another beautiful kick away. High spiraling. Ayers has been a magic maker all night. Let's sit and watch as he takes it up past the 40, up to the 42. You can just kind of hear this stadium get a little quiet every time number 10 touches it. A missed opportunity for Trevon Stewart and the Houston D. He knows he'd love to have that one back. His Cougars, though, still dominating tonight. In game number 6 here in 2015, it has already been a record-setting year for Greg Warden. He's closing in on another, just 20 yards away from setting the school record for rushing yards by a quarterback, Lionel Wilson. Back in 1981, Ward already has set the mark for rushing touchdowns by a QB. With 11 coming into this one, he has added two more to that total tonight. Plus, he set the single-game rushing record by a quarterback earlier this year when his 182-yard performance against the Golden Hurricane of Tulsa. He is the real deal, and there's been a lot of talk and a lot of good fun with Tom Herman. He's kind of inherited the nickname the Quarterback Whisperer around Houston for his work with Braxton Miller and JT Barrett last year at Ohio State, and he's carried that over with his relationship is on the field working of Greg Ward and what they've been able to accomplish. First time tonight, Farrow is into the secondary. A big rumble up to the 25-yard line. The senior from Hurst, Texas hasn't had a lot of room, but he burst for 31 that time.
He's the guy we talked about as an impact player outside of Ward, and we hadn't seen much of him.
Farrow straight up the gut, gets 2, maybe 3 yards. Red wine brings him down. There has been talk of Ward entering the Heisman race as far as the numbers that he has put. And Brian, I'm curious your thoughts on his status moving forward, if he can stay among the nation's elite there and continue, if he continues to put up these type of numbers and be a realistic shot at that. Farrow gets another gaping hole over the left side. He'll pick up first down yardage.
Well, I mentioned that to some of my friends during the week as I was watching tape of Greg Ward. I was surprised there was no chatter at all about him and the Heisman. And I suspect that it will happen if they continue to win and continue to put up the numbers they're putting up, especially him. We talked about the graphic earlier about him having 200 yards passing and 100 yards rushing. He's actually averaging over 250 throwing the football and over 100 rushing. The numbers are quite eye-popping, especially since you mentioned he's only been under center for really the equivalent of one season.
Yeah, he started the final 8 games last year. He replaced John O'Korn, who was struggling for Houston. His first start, he went to Memphis and handed the Tigers their only American Athletic Conference loss a season ago, and then he was off and running. 11-2 as a starter. Second down and 8, the option look. He'll pitch it to Jackson up ahead behind an Ayers block. Jackson spikes forward to the 4. Close to another first down. Looks like about a half a yard shy, setting up third and short. Freshman Roderick Teamer in on that last tackle. Third and short. Houston will move the chains, pick up enough for the first down. like an injured Green Wave defender down. That'll give time to Tom Herman to try to script something up. His team has been solid in the red zone tonight. Try to keep an eye on these wide receivers. We've mentioned Chance Allen with his blocking ability. Well, DeMarcus Ayers is able to do the same.
Yeah, bottom right of the screen, we see him engaged in a perfect open field, downfield block to give his running back a chance. And you have to have guys that not only can do that, but are willing to do it. And you hear that statement, you say, what are you talking about, willing to do it? Because not all those guys out on the edge think that that's part of their job. And you got to credit Tom Herman and the job that he's done, Major Applewhite, of understanding that this is part of the job. And especially with a guy behind center like Greg Ward, who is so explosive, if you just give him a chance, he's going to turn very little into huge amounts of yardage.
Hopefully just a cramp there for Corey Redwine. Have we got a pair of outstanding matchups Saturday on ESPN. First up, 3:30 Eastern, 7th-ranked Michigan State travels to Ann Arbor to take on the suddenly resurgent Jim Harbaugh, 12th-ranked Wolverines. And then at 7, a huge showdown just down the highway. Two of the SEC's three undefeated teams, number 8 Florida, number 6 LSU. Both games on ESPN, also streaming live on Watch ESPN. Farrow the back alongside Ward. Ward looking for the hat trick. Can he get number 3? He does. Dances in. Touchdown, Houston.
That's Major Applewhite's favorite play down near the end zone. It's a straight Wildcat slash Wild Cougar play, but again, he just has to leave his same guy in at quarterback and run him right around the edge, and they do it so easily. And again, I want to give credit to that O-line that has been hodgepodge put together this day, but have done a really good job up front of clearing pass for their running back.
Another big night from Greg Ward, his 3rd rushing touchdown. Houston on a roll. Houston on top here, 35-7. Greg Ward Jr. scored 4 rushing touchdowns against SMU last weekend. Off and running again tonight, 3 more here against Tulane.
Well, coming into the game, he was tied with Leonard Fournette right down the road at LSU with 11. He's added to that total again tonight. He's just an unstoppable force. Either way, he decides to move the football.
216 yards through the air, 84 more on the ground. He's accounted for 4 touchdowns. Honorable mention All-State coming out of high school at John Tyler High School. Led Texas 4A his senior year with over 4,200 passing yards. Looked like when he arrived at Houston, he started 2013 as the backup quarterback. They moved him to receiver last season, then made the change, as we talked about, midway through the year. And he has excelled under Tom Herman and Major Applewhite's guidance. And he's just a junior, and he's so young. I mean, he's just really scratching the surface, and that's what people kind of have to realize. This is only his 14th start of his career tonight, just to see the things that he can pull off on the field and show the composure. I think that's the thing that sticks out to me, is how he handles himself. They say he can be coached. You know, Major's been around some good quarterbacks, Vince Young and Colt McCoy, and kind of a combination of those two as he continues to mature. You know, McCoy with his deadly accuracy, Young's athleticism. It's kind of a combo package, and again, still young in his career. Going to be fun to follow his path and how far he can take Houston. Devin Powell back to work. Underneath route is caught, upended at the 37-yard line. Hit put on by Adrian McDonald. They hit the tight end for the first time tonight. Chandler Jones, a sophomore here in New Orleans, St. Augustine High School.
Well, our impact player on offense, Sherman Beatty, we have not seen much of him. He only had 2 yards rushing in the first half. We saw him get the first 2 carries of the series.
There's a gaping hole straight up the gut. Right on cue, that's Beatty. He'll take it for 14 yards onto the Houston side. Wilson brings him down.
And I thought they would find better ways to get him into the passing game out of the backfield. He's so versatile, and he's so effective out of the backfield. And with a guy like Devin Powell, who's just getting behind center for the first time in a while, I thought he might be a security blanket for him when he needs to throw the football. But he hasn't been able to run the football out of the backfield as well. We haven't seen much of him. We're starting to see more of him as the night progresses.
Play fake by Powell, looking right. Home run ball, deep downfield. Caught for a moment and then jarred free, incomplete. Oh, what a hit put on that time by Lee Hightower, the Boise State transfer. Timed it perfectly, and he kept it clean. That's textbook.
He's done the same thing earlier in this football game. He makes sure that those receivers know that he's there when they catch a football. He does not shy away from contact, and that's not something that's characteristic in all defensive backs. But being a strong safety, they always seem to like to bring it.
That's textbook. He avoided the targeting. He stayed lower, that lower half of the body, and he took him out hard and jarred it free. Gang tackling, loss of three or two on second down. Nowhere to go for Rob Kelly.
And we're starting to see that athleticism of that Houston front three and how active they are, how they maintain that same intensity throughout the ball game. They had a slow start last week. Coach Herman said they were sluggish out the gate versus SMU. But after SMU came out at halftime, they only allowed them 7 points and 89 yards in the second half of that ball game last week.
They've brought a lot of pressure on third downs. Let's see if they do it again here. It looked like they were getting in position, and now Powell checks up. He's going to keep it conservative on the ground with the handoff. Marker comes in. Kelly, actually with a pretty good run up near the first down, about a yard and a half shy. He gets 11. There is a flag down at midfield. Beatty and Roberts tied up talking a little bit. Penalty goes against Tulane.
Yeah. It was Devinez again on Hines, the inside linebacker. He had him locked up outside of his shoulder pads, and that's all I did my entire career was hold. That's all you do when you block, but you hold inside the interior of the shoulder pads. When they get out onto the edge, that's where the referee has to call it. Holding is taut, but you've got to get those hands inside. And when they remove themselves from your body, you got to let go.
Timeout taken by Houston.
First timeout of the second half called by Houston.
3:21 to go, third quarter. Houston on top, the defense setting the tone. Lee Hightower missed a good chunk of last year with an injury. He's back in full health, delivering the boom. Cougars rolling in the bayou. Devin Powell filling in for the injured Tanner Lee. A tough go against this Houston defense. A top 10 D for the Cougars, getting the job done once again. 35-7. Houston on top, alongside Brian Kinch and Sean Kinney, back with you from Yulman Stadium here in New Orleans. A magnificent Friday night weather-wise. A lot of things happening this weekend. Seems like there always is when you get to New Orleans. Last night, the Saints picked up a big win against Atlanta. Tulane in some trouble, though, here on the home turf. Down 35-7, third and a mile.
It looks like Houston's bringing everyone.
Here comes Taylor on a blitz. They throw the slant. Safe call. Bro makes the catch. They get nine. And another punt coming for Peter Piccarelli.
Stymied most of the night, that Tulane offense. And again, it just seems like Houston is feeding upon that into the second half. And really, as they did last week, might be playing their best football of the night.
Kick is away by Piccarelli. Fair catch signaled for by Ayers at the 19-yard line. It's another tough test for number one Ohio State. Saturday Night Football presented by Wells Fargo. The Buckeyes and the two quarterback attack of Cardale Jones, JT Barrett take on Penn State and the stout Nittany Lion defense. Ezekiel Elliott and the Buckeyes welcome the Nittany Lions to the Shoe. Penn State top-ranked Ohio State Saturday, 8 o'clock Eastern on ABC. Also streaming live on Watch ESPN. That Penn State defense allowing only 14 points per game this year. I'm not sure they could slow down this guy, though. Greg Ward on the season, over 600 rushing yards. You see the touchdowns. That leads the country. See if Fournette can keep pace against a pretty stout Florida defense tomorrow night in Baton Rouge. This American Athletic Conference off to such a good start. You're witnessing, I think, a real surge in this conference as they get their treading in the group of five. You look at some of the wins by the conference schools as Ward is looking downfield. Nothing really panned out. He tried to sneak a pass to McCloskey. He was out of bounds. But look at what the AAC has been able to accomplish. They're 4-3 against the ACC after South Florida stunned Syracuse. They have beaten teams. They've beaten three teams from the Power Five conferences this year. They're winning despite the struggles of the Florida schools, with UCF hitting tough times, South Florida and Willie Taggart and company. They're 11-3 against the group of five brethren. Two of those losses coming to BYU. So it has the makings of what could be a very special year. Down goes Ward. He's sacked back at the 13-yard line. Ade Aruna, redshirt sophomore out of Nigeria, making the play.
Something we haven't seen much out of Tulane, being able to corral Ward and bring him down in the backfield. Sorely missed for that Green Wave defense all night.
Aruna is a real neat story. Former defensive coordinator John Sumrall was actually in Birmingham, Alabama, and he watched Aruna play a game of pickup basketball, and that's what kind of caught his attention. He's really young to the sport. He was known for his basketball ability in high school, but they saw his size, they saw his athleticism, and he has found a spot on this Tulane defense. Just a sophomore playing only his fourth year of organized football. The American Athletic Conference, a busy day and night lined up. BYU right now, in fact, that's a final. BYU knocks off Cincinnati 38-24. BYU, one of those teams hoping to get a New Year's Six spot. South Florida, UConn tomorrow on ESPNU. Ole Miss and Memphis. Can the Tigers and Justin Fuente stay perfect? Big, big matchup there. And you have Tulsa and East Carolina as well. From the 34, Powell rolls right, throws underneath, incomplete.
Same play they ran earlier, a little bootleg, which is perfect. It's right up the alley of Devin Powell. And this time he went for the tight end underneath. He had him earlier, but went for the comeback and missed that one. And then he chose the tight end at the second level and missed him as well. Nothing seems to be going right for Tulane.
Quick hitter over the right side. Hilliard hit the hole hard, and then he was hit hard.
I love the attitude of this defense, and we get a look at Stephen Taylor, the guy number 41 right there, who is just a menace in the backfield this year with 12 tackles for loss. That leads the nation and 8 sacks. It's second in the nation. He's been a little bit idle tonight because Tulane really hasn't dropped back and thrown the football much. But a very dynamic pass rusher and playmaker for that Houston Cougar defense.
Third down. They've been bringing blitz after blitz. They keep it up. Shot toward the sideline. Too tall. Bro had some separation on Wilson. But Powell felt the heat. And a three and out for Tulane.
When you have an offense like Tulane that has struggled in pretty much every category that there is, with the exception of their red zone offense, and then you have to bring in a backup in the sixth game of the year. That's just a very, 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 very uncomfortable place for any coach to be.
Zach Block on the punt this one. Ayers, look at the move by Ayers. One man to beat, that's the punter. See you later. He's done it again. Touchdown, Houston. What a night for DeMarcus Ayers.
Kind of just wrote that one off, thought, man, he's got Tulane defenders all around him. As soon as he catches that football, it's over. And then he shakes one, and then he's untouched the entire rest of the way. Talk about a hidden gem, a guy that I didn't even notice in the first two ball games that I looked at this Houston football team. He is an unbelievably dynamic player. And I think even more so as a specialist and a return guy. He's just it's a game changer. You can get a guy like that returning for you.
The longest American Athletic Conference punt return of the season. It comes from the AAC 2013 Special Teams Player of the Year. DeMarcus Ayers, 73 yards, all smiles on the Cougar sideline at Houston. Putting it to Tulane tonight, 42-7. Hugs all the way around, and look at the initial move to get free. And then the speed, no way Block's going to make that tackle, the punter.
And that was Rob Kelly that got shook. Rob Kelly's a big old fullback for Tulane. Good cover guy, being able to get downfield, but quick feet he did not have. Or certainly not the ones that matched the feet of Ayers on that move. They broke him loose.
175 punt return yards for DeMarcus Ayers in this one, and he has frustrated and silenced the Tulane sideline. On the return, trying to stretch it horizontally across the field is the freshman Ricky Preston. A couple of true freshmen in the receiving corps for the Green Wave with both Hicks and Preston. So the third quarter comes to an end, a quarter dominated by the 24th ranked team in the country. Houston and their defense set the tone early. The Cougars delivering the blows, the defense setting the tone. Hightower with the hit. Ward and the offense taking control. Three more rushing touchdowns for the Heisman hopeful, and then DeMarcus Ayers caps it off. Houston big here in the Bayou. Tulane has been tough here at Yulman Stadium this year, but a tough night against Houston. The Cougars at 5-0. Atop the West in a tight race in the American Athletic Conference have put a hurt on the Green Wave here. 42-7 as we start quarter number four. Sean Kenny alongside Brian Kenshin. And a lot of questions coming in. How would Houston respond? This team back in the rankings for the first time since 2011. The tight circle that Coach Herman talked about. It's great to get praise. You know, it was interesting to hear his take about how everybody, every human, it's our nature to want to hear the praise, but it's how you accept that but still look for the critique of the coaches and try to improve on the individual front, that he kept preaching and preaching to his guys and will continue that sermon throughout the course of the year. Larry Dace makes his first catch up near the 30. It is a log jam in the West. The American Athletic, we talked about the resurgence of this conference. Take a look. Houston, Memphis, and Navy all sitting at 2-0. Navy suffering their first loss to Notre Dame. Houston and Memphis still perfect on the year. The Tigers with a showdown against Ole Miss tomorrow.
Three unbeaten teams in the American Athletic Conference, Temple along with that, those two teams we just showed.
Pass a bit too tall, incomplete. Wilson with the coverage.
Going back to what you were talking about, what Tom Herman said about criticism, he said successful people seek out criticism. And they want to know what they're not doing well. And the job of a coach, that's basically your job, is to point out what you're not seeing. And it's very difficult as a player sometimes, because that's a part of the job. You're never going to be perfect, but your goal is to try to be perfect. And hopefully in that effort, you get pretty close.
Piccarelli is back on the punt. Gets the kick away. Fair catch signaled for some contact. It's picked up by Tulane. And let's see how the officials are going to sort this out.
That was right off of the hat of Tulane. Landed right on the helmet.
Thomas just kept on a running through the tunnel. A lot of traffic in the area as we take a look.
Right on top of Nickerson's helmet, number 17.
The ball illegally touched a member of the kicking team at the 29-yard line. First down, Houston.
It's a good call. There was a lot of traffic, as we mentioned, but right off the dome, Houston football when we come back. Cougars 42-7 here in New Orleans. 42-7 Houston on top of Tulane, as we have 13:26 to go in this fourth and final quarter. All Cougars, they scored on their very first touch on the offensive side, a 49-yard touchdown pass. They have not looked back. Special teams, dynamic play from Ward and Ayers, and that hard-hitting defense, the familiar recipe for Houston so far this season. Trying to stretch it out, they work it to Ryan Jackson. Jackson pushes ahead for two hard-fought yards, brought down by Monroe. This Tulane defense has been on the field a lot tonight. Royce LaFrance, Smart, Redwine, Aruna, Thomas and Marley, the linebackers. Sean Wilson, one of the interior tackles. Second down and eight. They fake the jet sweep. Farrow up the middle. Gets 5 yards. Take a look at the east side of the American Conference. And Temple right now, the clear front runner. Coach Rule and company, 5-0. They took care of Tulane last week. See UConn, East Carolina still within striking distance. Donald Gage makes the catch up to the 41-yard line. Temple is an intriguing team, the way they play defense. That's a team that realistically could go a long way as well this year.
Yeah, they're very similar to what Houston likes to do, man coverage. They're not as risky. They don't like to send as many guys. They like to have safeties behind them when they play
after
man.
The
but they
over.
Are a very aggressive defense that gives you trouble.
Number 91 of the defense, 15-yard penalty, first down.
Eldrick Washington with the unsportsmanlike conduct. Upper right-hand corner here for Tulane.
Just can't engage with those guys. They have the hardest job on the field, those referees do. And you certainly can't get in their face like that.
Frustrating night. Penalty-wise, Ward Chase avoids LaFrance. Nearly a one-handed grab along the sideline. The heat put on that time by Royce LaFrance. We haven't had a lot of time to talk about LaFrance. He's one of the best that Tulane has seen come through here. Third on the all-time sack list with 16 and a half. Nearly had number 17 right there.
Yeah, had a really good day against Central Florida. Had actually two sacks in a row at one point in that football game. Just a great guy off the edge. Perfect frame and quickness.
Second down, it's Farrow making a quick jab to the outside using the stiff arm, barreling to the 38-yard line. Eric Thomas the stop.
I just want to make sure we don't forget about the fact that we have five linemen on the field right now who are playing a different position or playing a position for the first time for an extended period and have done a really fabulous job of opening up not just the running lanes, but protecting Ward when he drops back to throw the football.
Here comes the pressure. The ball batted up in the air on the screen. Getting a hand up was Aruna. Using that tall frame of his, 6'5", we talked about his athleticism that time, getting his right paw up to deflect it away.
And they had the perfect call against man coverage, and they were bringing everybody, but just can't get it to him. That would have been a perfect slow screen. You don't see those slow screens much anymore. They're a real art.
Let's go back to your playing days. Quick question. When you look at this offensive line and you have so much inexperience, lots of times when you have a quarterback injury, coaches talk about knocking down the load, the volume of plays and so forth. Do you take that same approach with the offensive line?
I think so. They're a very tight group. They know what they're doing. They can handle it.
42-7, Houston in control. 11:14 to go here in the fourth quarter. Friday night in New Orleans, Yulman Stadium, the setting, alongside Brian Kenshin. I'm Sean Kenny. Welcome back. Fourth quarter, Houston in control. The Cougars looking to go 6-0, 3-0 in the American Athletic Conference. Well on their way. They have dominated from the start. And now Tulane, this offense, which has struggled against this hard-hitting Houston defense, will go with the fifth-year senior, Jordy Joseph, now handling the quarterback reins. Devin Powell's night appears to be done. And the question moving forward for the Green Wave is obviously the health of Tanner Lee. Curtis Johnson is high on the redshirt sophomore of Jesuit High School. He sustained a concussion sometime last week in the loss to Temple. He wasn't diagnosed or as far as being ruled out until midweek this week, but they're hoping they can get him back next week and moving forward, because he is the guy that Johnson wants under center.
And they'll still have the same issues they had before he was injured, is being able to run the football. You cannot be one-dimensional in this conference, in this league, on any level. You have to be able to do both things really well, or decent, to be able to give the passing game a chance. And they haven't been able to figure it out all year, and I think that front five has really suffered a lot because of it. Those three lopsided losses, especially the two earlier with Georgia Tech and Duke, I really think shook them and knocked them off their kilter a little bit. And they've never really been able to find their groove offensively on the year. But they've got to figure out a way to be able to run the football.
Time out.
Downhill and balance out
that offense.
First
of the second half, 30-second timeout.
Devin Powell, 11 of 28, the 88 yards. Did not make a mistake, and the game plan coming in was to establish the ground game. Tulane knew they had to get that deep stable of backs going and kind of let Powell manage the game, and they just could not get the consistent push like you were talking about from the get-go.
No, they couldn't. They got into a little rhythm in one drive, and then the next two plays, Powell just chunks the ball down the field for 50 yards in apparent desperation. They need to have a better, more effective passing game as well, and it needs to come off of play action. But when you can't run it, you can't play action.
Jordy Joseph, fifth-year senior, has attempted only two career passes. We'll see if he puts up number three. Nope, they'll keep it on the ground. Straight up the middle. Good yardage. Opening up over the right side for Dontrell Hilliard. It's a pickup of 10. The 16-yard line, this time over the left side, Hilliard gets three. So let's, you know, do a little speculating. That's what makes it fun with the teams, you know, the heavy hitters in this American Athletic. Houston, and, you know, if they can knock off Vanderbilt coming up in the near future, they would have two wins against Power 5 schools, having already knocked off Louisville. Memphis could really put together an impressive resume if they can take care of Ole Miss. They have a win against Kansas. They have a victory against Bowling Green, who can make some noise in the MAC. And you have Temple, who already has a victory against Penn State. They still have Notre Dame on their schedule. These are all teams looking for that spot. I mean, you look about the group of five and
right.
Boise State, what they've been able to do. The Broncos have it cooking. Toledo is perfect on the season out of the MAC. Those are the teams that Houston's kind of keeping an eye on as they work their way through the American.
And I think just the turnaround at Houston alone is just impressive to me. And obviously the emergence of Greg Ward.
There's a shot downfield. Bro has a step marker down. He makes the catch. Bro using his speed all the way to the 26-yard line. The flag thrown back at the 40. 51 yards. McDonald finally able to corral Devin Bro.
Holding number three of the defense. Penalty will be declined. First down.
So the play sticks, and it's the biggest gain of the night for the Green Wave.
Really good move by Devin Bro and William Jackson, who knew he was beat, grabbed hold of cloth to try to prevent it and get away with it, but he didn't.
Joseph rolls left, settles underneath, making the catch is Beatty. He is a good receiver out of the backfield. Second down for Tulane. Houston will improve to 6-0. They will take on a struggling UCF team next week in Orlando, and then they have Vanderbilt, the SEC matchup. But look at how they finish. Couldn't have scripted a better way with Memphis on the 14th, and how about that November 27th matchup against Navy? What might be at stake around the holidays with that showdown?
And they're only going to get better. Every week, every time they notch another victory, they build confidence in each other and themselves in what Coach Herman is trying to do. And at the end of the year, if they've managed to go unbeaten, that would be a very impressive turnaround in his first year at Houston.
Third down throw and catch, and it will be a first down as they get it to the tight end. So nice job here by Jordy Joseph working Tulane down the field. The group of five champion ranked the highest at the end of the year by the playoff committee will get the prize spot in one of the six New Year's bowls in the New Year's Six lineup. And again, that's where we mentioned you compete against the Boise States, the Toledos from that group of five. The nice thing about the American Athletic Conference this year, they have the conference championship scheduled Saturday, December 5th, as the West will meet the East to determine the champion. So a lot to be said, but certainly Houston on paper has enough firepower to get there and run it. Shot toward the end zone, incomplete.
When I like what Tom Herman said when I asked him the difference between what he's doing now as a head coach and as an offensive coordinator, he said he misses the gelling he got to do with the players and the interaction with the players and missed those relationships. Obviously now he said, I have it with my nine coaches, he says, but I miss the everyday interaction and being able to build relationships with his players, which obviously is the reason he's having such success, because the first thing a player has to know about a coach is that he cares about you. And then after that, everything's gravy.
Third down, here comes pressure, and down goes Joseph. Trevon Stewart with the sack, a loss of seven.
From his free safety position, we talked about the aggressiveness of this Houston defense even late into this ball game with a 42-7 lead. Todd Orlando, the defensive coordinator, is still dialing up the blitzes to make sure that points don't make the board.
Fourth down, here they come again. Joseph to the end zone. breakdown in communication as he was looking for the corner route. Teddy Veal was cutting toward the post, and Tulane comes up empty. Houston football, 5:03 to go here in New Orleans. Eastern on ESPN, also streaming live on Watch ESPN. Kyle Postma, 6'3", 205-pound sophomore. Trinity Valley Community College transfer now orchestrating the show, and he hands it off straight up the middle. A burst. New jersey's in there for Houston. That time it was Koikema making the run, 17 yards up the middle. Postma, Brian's a real interesting story. He looked like he was going to be a position change, very similar to what we've seen Greg Ward do with Houston. He was a quarterback at Trinity Valley College. He actually started his career in 2013 as a walk-on at Houston, then transferred to Trinity Valley. He threw for over 3,300 yards and 38 touchdowns en route to a perfect season. Well, this year he was backing up two quarterbacks, so they decided to put him at receiver. He actually caught four balls for 82 yards in the season opener against Tennessee Tech just 4 days after making the position change. And now they decided to put him back at quarterback to serve as the backup to Greg Ward, a terrific athlete. Tom Herman talked about he was just too good of an athlete to have on the side with the clipboard. We needed him at the receiver position. We mentioned the hit they took to graduation. He contributed there. But now with the depth emerging, guys like Ayers and Dunbar and Allen, the way Allen's adjusted coming over from Oregon, they have put him back in that quarterback as the number two guy to Greg Ward.
That seems to be the right position to move from. But it's great that they have that kind of athleticism on their roster. And obviously, having their first recruiting class this past off season, and they'll be able to bolster that as they move down the line. But getting athletes that can play multiple positions, especially the ones that are very, very high profile, like the quarterback position, the wide receiver position.
On the read, Postma lost his grip there as he went to make a cut, falls ahead for three. LaFrance jumps on top. You mentioned the recruiting trail for Houston. They're already starting to feel the impact of the success that they are having this year. You look at the state of Texas. In the 2016 recruiting class, there are 35 committed among the ESPN 300 prospects from the state of Texas. 35 ESPN 300s. 21 have already chosen in-state school. That was a top priority for Tom Herman, was to keep the in-state kids here and get them to Houston. And the success that they have had. Last weekend he was on the recruiting trail at a couple of high school games. As Postma shows his athleticism left to right, he'll dive ahead to the 39 and pick up the first down. And the key for Houston keeping this going is to keep some of the local talent. That Ed Oliver verbally is committed to Houston. One of the dominant down tackles in the state, as you take a look at some of the big names and where they're going. I mean, you look at what Houston goes up against. TCU, Baylor, both unbeaten. Texas A&M off to a great start. They're unbeaten. Will Texas get it back and rolling? That's what he has to go up against. But guys like Oliver, and moving forward with some of the other recruits around the Houston area, if they can keep them around, certainly enough talent to go around. Bouncing off the pile up ahead to the 21-yard line. And Oliver, number 5 in the ESPN 300. He is verbally committed to Houston. And you've been a part of the process. You know how momentum can build quickly with one or two big names, in this case, 4-star prospects jumping aboard.
You're only as good as your players, and any coach will tell you that. I coached the middle school, high school football over the last decade or so, and you just can't win without talent, and recruiting is the way you get there. That's the only way you can get there, and you have to be able to get the kids that can help you, that are right for your program, that have character, that can work hard and instill into each other and to build into each other. I think the philosophies we talked about with what Herman's trying to do very similar to the way Urban Meyer coaches. We've seen the success that he's had at the different schools, Florida and Ohio State, and even back to his Utah days. But that's the philosophy. Like I said earlier, if kids don't know you don't care about it, if they know you, they care about you, they'll do anything for you. And you can't fake it because they know it. And when talking to him, Herman, on the phone this week, he's a genuine guy who cares about his kids. And like I said, that's the first step. And once you get their hearts, man, they'll do anything. They'll go through a wall for you. And we're seeing the way that they're playing this year in his first season here at Houston.
Inside a minute to go, Houston will improve to 6-0. Tulane will drop their second straight. They march to 2-4. And Brian, just some closing thoughts as Houston celebrates another victory. I think we both agree the offensive line, with all the injuries, that's going to be a key area moving forward as they face stiffer competition.
Well, the light's going to get brighter and brighter on them the more wins they have, and especially on Greg Ward, their quarterback. And like I said, I think if they continue, he's going to get a lot more chatter further and further down the road for that Heisman Trophy, which he is a legitimate candidate for, in my opinion.
Greg Ward Jr., 4 more touchdowns. He throws for 222 yards. He adds 3 more rushing touchdowns, a NCAA high, 14 rushing scores on the season. Your final score, Houston 42, Tulane 7. Coming up, it's the Geico ESPN High School Football Showcase as Gonzaga from D.C. takes on Maryland powerhouse DeMatha right after these messages.